Thank you so much for joining our webinar today. We are going to be discussing, and Dr. Baca is going to be sharing with us about different aspects of mental illness, addiction, substance use, and he's going to be taking questions. So we're excited to be having him share with us today. Before we get started, I'm going to tell you a little bit about relink.org in case you're not familiar with it. So when you go to relink.org, you can click on Find Help Now. And when you do that, you're going to be given different options. The first option is you can enter a location. So you can search by city, you can search by zip code, you can search within miles. You can do different options as well as if you would like to search at through a county, and you can do different mile ranges. Once you do that, you're going to have different categories of care that you can choose from. And right here we have addiction recovery highlighted. That's with the orange arrow. And then you have different options within that category that you've selected. So I made this a little bit bigger so that you can see the different options. We do have addiction recovery, reentry, human trafficking, family services, emergency and crisis, basic needs, behavioral health, and different ways that you can get involved. Relink.org does have over 16,000 different resources in all of these different areas, and we're free to use, and we're also free to be listed on. So if you clicked addiction recovery, you would see these different options that would come up here. We have treatment, housing, peer and other support services, harm reduction prevention services. So these are all different subcategories. When you click into them, you're going to get lists and lists of different resources for whatever area that you've selected. We are in all 88 counties, and we have resources in all of those. One other thing I'd like to point out is that you can have your own login for your page. So if you're a provider, we encourage you to go in and look at your information, make sure it's accurate on relink.org, that you have accurate hours, information, updated website. One thing that we notice is that when there is turnover, a lot of times people's information isn't updated for the correct employee to contact. So you can do that by having your own provider login. You can edit your data. And if you have any other questions, you can also ask us to help you, and we're happy to go through that with you. Here, you can see that if you click up in the top right corner, you can make relink.org into Spanish as well. So you can change the whole database to be Spanish if you have someone that is Spanish speaking. This is our bed capacity project that we're working on this year. We're really trying to get people, if you are a provider that has a rehab center, a detox center, any type of recovery housing, to go in and update your bed capacity weekly. It takes less than a minute, but by doing so, then when people click on relink.org and they're looking, they can see how many beds you have open, if you're full. If you have an unknown, that means you haven't updated it in the last week. So it really draws attention to your provider information, and people really catches their eye that you have a bed open if you have green. So we encourage people to do that, and we're asking people to do that each week. There is going to be one social work CEU awarded to participants of today's webinar. So that will be coming to you. Next week, we're going to be sending those out. So look for that to come in your email. And if you need to contact us for any reason, you can follow us on social media. You can ask us to be on our newsletter emailing list. We email out our newsletters quarterly, but each month we also email out our information on the webinars. Or if you have any other general information you need, there's the phone number and the email address for Relink. So I am going to stop sharing and turn it over to Dr. Baca, and he's going to present.
Okay, we'll get it going here. Hopefully that's working. Can you see that?
Yep.
Excellent. So I am Dr. Joseph Baca, and what I hope to do today is to talk about, I think we can a lot of times understand the what's going on physically when there's something physically going on, and then how that can help us understand the mental illness component of things, and then even more how substance use is related to that. I was born in Jersey, so if I go backwards a little bit in my talk, hopefully you can have someone to translate. It won't be Spanish. I did my emergency residency to start in Michigan, and I've been in Mansfield since 99. I did 3 years in the Richland County Jail as medical, not as a person in there. And I did my addiction medicine specialty 3 years ago. And I also can't quite see it here, but maybe, but I enjoy helping at NASCAR at Mid-Ohio Heart. I mean, at Mid-Ohio Raceway. So if I go a little bit too fast, we'll have time at the end to be able to try to catch up with stuff. And I think the key is that I want to just do is that if just get some understanding and some knowledge, because I think that's powerful. And this talk is just a compilation of a lot of different things that have come up that I think people have some misunderstandings or not able to understand. And if they can, then it can be able to help you help patients even more. So why do people get physically ill and then even mentally ill? I mean, one of the things is disobeying the law of physics. When I'm 15 feet up on a ladder and it falls and my pelvis lands against the ground, something is going to crack when there's more than 900 pounds of force with things. We know that there's also a way our body was designed that some things are inevitable. If you put 10 people into a 10 by 10 room and one of them has chicken pox and you keep them in there for an hour, at 1 hour, all 10 people are going to have chicken pox. And it's just inevitable as to how it happens. And then there's a gene component, and that can affect things physically. I think we've seen when people have some genes that have affected them physically, but that can also affect them emotionally and make them more prone when things are out of balance and can make them more prone to having substance use issues. But just because they have a gene, the DNA is not their destiny. And I think one of the big keys that we'll see as we're talking through things is when things are not in balance and when there's not moderation, that's when the body gets out of whack with things. And sometimes it's because things are born, sometimes because you've been stretching it and making it get out of balance. But trying to figure out where it's not in balance is what's going to be able to be good for you to be able to help take care of patients, especially with mental illness and with substance use. And there's also the environment and trauma. When you are repeatedly told that you're worthless, when you repeatedly have all kinds of physical trauma and as you're growing up, it's going to scar how you're developing and it's going to affect you. At times it can be physically because of broken bones and things, but certainly a broken mind and how you're thinking of yourself is also going to be affected by that. So, I mean, the Bible talks about the sins of the parents and that the entire family is infected to the third and fourth generations. And we can see, you know, especially probably child abuse is one of the things that we can see going down and down because that's the only thing they learned. But it can be broken and be able to get thousands of generations to be able to do the right thing when it gets broken. Sometimes people get sick because of their sins. When you are doing things in the way that your body wasn't designed to do when you're taking in substances that it wasn't designed to be, it's going to end up affecting you. And sometimes that needs to be addressed. If you are constantly beating up people, constantly raping people, or whatever other kind of crazy things there are, that's definitely going to have an effect and that needs to be dealt with or it's not going to work. Sometimes, and you may have seen this, sometimes it's just because God wants to be glorified. There was the blind man and people were arguing with Jesus, hey, you know, was his parents or who was it that sinned? And Jesus said, no, I'm just going to heal him. This is why it is. And there are times I can't explain it. I may have some questions when I hopefully get to heaven, but that's sometimes a part of things is it just supposed to be. Other times it's so you can comfort others, and whether it be comforting from grief, well, we know that especially peer recovery with people that have been in substance use, people are going to be able to help others in ways that I can't, because I can't relate to the what they've been through, but they are going to be able to be a huge help to others once their body gets right back into the balance that it was designed to be. We know that at last year, there were over 107,000 Americans that died from an opiate overdose. So that's one every 5 minutes. That means that 12 Americans are going to die during this talk from an opiate overdose. Not getting as much press is that there were 160,000 Americans that died from a liver-related disease. So that means that 20 Americans are going to, excuse me, alcohol-related disease. So 20 Americans are going to die from an alcohol-related issue during this talk. And nicotine, there's going to be 60 Americans that are going to die from a nicotine-related issue during this talk. A lot of times I ask who hasn't been affected by addiction, but it's who doesn't it affect? We've continued to have 1 and 2 year olds that have accidentally gotten into parents' medications that have overdosed. We've had people up through their 80s. A couple years ago, the 2 80-year-olds were found with the needle still in their arms and had overdosed together. There are tons of grandparents and family members that now have custody of kids. Unfortunately, there are dozens of kids each day that are born having to go through withdrawal to begin their life, and that's how it's affecting them right from the beginning. We know that this is a multi-million dollar industry, so it's not going to just go away. And when people get into recovery, their dealers are going to keep hounding them because they want their money. Most of the gunshots in our area, most of the thefts and robbery, and all the extra security costs that you have to have it when you go to the store with the tags and that are largely substance use related. So hopefully we'll get some knowledge, but even more so that you can hopefully get a little bit of understanding. I wasn't great in school at memorizing things, but if I could picture things and understand a little better what's going on, then that was able to work a little bit better. And hopefully that's the same thing that will happen here. So the biggest question is, with substance use, why are people become addicted? Because I don't know anyone that was ever born that wanted to be addicted. But you can see the genes coming early on. There's a gene that once it's turned on, we especially know with alcohol, there's several different genes that you get to a certain point and it's going to be once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic. Once you get that certain amount of alcohol. And you can see people that have tolerance to things. If at high school parties, there's often one person that's had a six pack and is up drinking, except dancing and the life of the party, while other people that have one or two are in the bathroom puking their guts out because they have a different set of genes that didn't turn things on. We know that they think that, we talk about alcohol especially affecting the liver, but there are some people that don't have the gene that gets that turned on. The same way there's the 100-year-old Russian lady that smokes 2 packs of cigarettes a day for 90 years and never got lung cancer or disease. She didn't have the cancer gene turned on, but she's certainly not going to be the most healthy. So the genes are to be respected. The same with environment. We know lots of kids that are 8, 10 years old who are given alcohol or marijuana gummies to go to sleep. And that's what they've been born with. And a lot of them have grown up in an environment where their parents are dealing or using, and that's all that they've known. And that definitely just adds to why people would be addicted. And people are, especially in the ED, we used to call people drug seekers, but really they're not drug seekers. They're actually trying to hide all the horror and the trauma that they had or to escape withdrawal. And our brains were designed to constantly want new rewards and to have new things. And that's why different substances and going from one to the other or mixing things is just adds to why people become addicted, because they're constantly wanting the latest new thing. And then with that, to get pleasant new memories and to be trying to reproduce that. One of the things that gets a lot of people in trouble is because you just can't trust your dealers anymore. In our area, there's an average of three substances in every sample that the crime lab goes through. And that's where, when we get someone that comes in that says they're addicted to fentanyl or they're addicted to cocaine, we check and see where things are because there probably is also meth or who knows whatever else that's mixed in with it. Our county last year, we know that with overdoses, most of it is from fentanyl, and we had 27 out of 28 had fentanyl in it, but it was the most lethal in only 22 of the overdoses we had. Cocaine is making a huge rise, and cocaine and fentanyl were in more than half. Cocaine was the only substance in one of the patients, and we had another one again last week that, especially older people, that the cocaine is such a strong vasoconstrictor that it kills people. It's not just opiates. And we have one where gabapentin was the most lethal, and that's becoming more and more pronounced in our community too. But why is this? And this is hopefully, I think, probably one of the biggest keys to be able to try to understand is our midbrain or the nucleus accumbens, which is our main pleasure center. It was designed to live at a dopamine level of like 40 or 50 as a baseline, and then maybe go up to 80 or 100. And that was the range that it was meant to be used. But substances were found that stretch this. And this is where things get out of whack and get out of balance. And we had talked that when things are out of balance, that's when you start getting illness. So if the baseline was 50, we know that recognition or Cedar Point can get you up to 80 to 100. Sex was 92. This was still an interesting study because a good meal went to 94. But then you get into the substances. So buprenorphine goes up to 400 instead of that 100. Tobacco and nicotine go to 450. Oxycodone goes to 500 instead of that 100 max that was there. THC goes up to 650. Alcohol goes up to roughly 800 instead of that 100. Heroin or fentanyl goes up to 975. And then the stimulants, cocaine goes up to 1,000, amphetamines to 1,100, and meth is just really messing with minds because it's going up to 1,500. So you can imagine how out of whack your brain is when it's yelled at to go 15 times higher than it was supposed to with everything. And the way it, there are a bunch of different ways that it gets this increased dopamine. And I don't put this, I just put this up to show that there are different ways that the dopamine gets increased. In the same way, different parts of the brain cause the dopamine to be increased too. And this is where we look at what is the substance and what medications might be able to help to mitigate that. So it's not just a one size fit all. It's again trying to see the overall picture of what's going on with things. And the route is also going to make a difference with how much you're yelling at with the dopamine. I think we know that IV is going to be the highest with things. A lot of times people think that snorting, because it's right next to the brain, is going to get a higher level and be faster. But actually, if you snort, it has to go into your bloodstream, get down into your lungs, and then up into the brain. So smoking is actually faster and going to have a higher peak than snorting does. The oral route is going to be the longest lasting and not quite as high a peak. I don't know if you've heard of people talk about boofing or booty bumping, but some people have found that meth can actually be absorbed quite well rectally when you've run out of veins. And so a lot of people end up doing meth rectally. I think too, people think, oh, the only way that people die from overdoses is IV. But in the middle of 21, it actually went that IV deaths actually were surpassed by smoking and snorting. So they most of the overdose deaths from opiates are from smoking and snorting, not from IV. What happens then is if you are have been getting your dopamine up to whatever it is, 1,000, 1,200, 1,500, and then you stop. After a short while, it's just like when you don't have water, you don't have food, you start going into starvation and desperation mode. And you start getting anxious, you start doing things even that you might not have normally done, even can overcome that you're pregnant and have another one that's with you, or that there's other people that are around and involved. And that's that starvation, desperation mode that gets people doing things that they just have to get back and get using again, unless they can get through these first couple of days of things. And what happens too is your brain starts saying, I'm not going to make as much of the cells that put out the dopamine because I don't like getting yelled at so much. And so you can see this is where the dopamine receptors with cocaine, with meth, alcohol, all these have less receptors that are putting out dopamine. So you need more substance to be able to get up to that 1100 or 1500 that your memory says, hey, this is really what I need to get up to. And so you have often a lower baseline dopamine level then, because instead of being at that 40 or 50, you may be at 20 or 30. There's something called tweaking with meth where you just keep using till you pass out, and then you take a little bit more, and then you pass out, and then you really pass out. And they've seen people have dopamine levels of two or three. And when they come into the withdrawal unit that I'm at, often they'll be out for 2 or 3 days, not able to do anything because they have just about nothing left in their dopamine. It has to slowly start getting back again. And so they need the same, you need more of the substance to get that same dopamine peak. And you have this gap that's going to be often for several months between your dopamine is low, and it's going to need your brain to trust to get those dopamine receptors or cells to be putting back out again, and that your brain is not needing to be at 1,000 or then 900, 800, it negotiates down. And that takes several months. And so that gap is the post-acute withdrawal syndrome. And this is an important part to be helping the brain to go alongside to get healed again. Because if we don't give it time, it's just going to go out of control very quickly again. So often the physical part is 3 days to get taken care of, 3, 4, or 5 days. It's 3 to 6 months with that post-acute withdrawal and a lot of the emotional component. But with stimulants, it takes 3 years to get the brain chemistry back. And with some of the new meth, there's question as to whether there are even some that have permanent damage with it. And it's 2 years for opiates and alcohol. And we tell people this right up front. This is at least a 2 to 3 year process to get the brain healed. And you got to have a backup plan to a backup plan down the line for healing. The hard thing is that we expect relapse at times in some people. It's been said that there are 7 major relapses for everyone that has a successful recovery. And that's a lot of patience, but it's also preparing and saying, if you relapse, please come back. Don't go hiding from me. And let's figure out a plan for what we need to do to be able to try to help get you on the right path with things. So, at what age does the brain stop developing? Age 25, right? And unfortunately, the last part to finish developing is the prefrontal cortex, which is sort of your inhibition center. And it's even worse in males, which is why a lot of us males do some pretty dumb things in our 20s, but we won't talk about that. But that also affects when you start using the substance. If you start using before the brain has fully developed at 25, there's actually wisdom to have age limits of 21. And I know Denmark and some other countries are looking at age 25 even to be the limits for a lot of these substances that are going to affect the growing brain. So if you start drinking by age 14, 15% are going to be an alcoholic at 25, versus if you start at 21, it's 2%. You can see marijuana was 38 to 5, and heroin was 71 to 2. Alcohol, we know that 20% of Americans consume 80% of the alcohol. And we talked earlier, it's more than just liver enzymes. It affects every cell that it goes to. So it affects the bone marrow, the pancreas, the brain. And some people, it doesn't affect the liver, but it affects the bone marrow. Some people, it doesn't affect the liver, but it affects the brain. And we try to show people, especially in their blood work, how it's affecting them. Benzodiazepines, I see as freeze-dried alcohol. They're hitting the same receptor system as alcohol. And so it may help short-term in withdrawal, but long-term, you're just substituting one of the wrong things for another. And part of things is based on how our bodies were designed. We know that women have a low enzyme that blocks the alcohol from being absorbed. And so the exact same amount of alcohol given to a woman and given to a man is going to have 30% more absorbed if you're a female. And if you have had gastric bypass, and especially taken out the top part of the stomach, you're going to have 50% more alcohol absorbed than you would before the gastric bypass. And alcohol is tricky because it hits six of your eight neurotransmitter systems. Most of the others hit just two or three. The two that aren't with the alcohol is actually nicotine, ironically. But the main one I see is alcohol is a large battle in trying to put in balance between GABA, which is trying to put the brakes in relaxing, and glutamate, which is like a Mack truck that's running down the hill and just keeps going and going faster and faster. And so what happens is you start putting the alcohol, and then in response to that, the glutamate system starts putting out more. And that's just with a one time. When it gets more chronic, the alcohol is putting more, and the glutamate system really keeps revving up, revving up, revving up. And then if you stop the alcohol, the glutamate system is going 150, 160 miles an hour. And that's going to take months before that actually gets back to the speed limit. And that's what gives you the anxiety, the tremors, the blood pressure. Everything is going from that glutamate being totally out of balance. And that's where the treatment is going to be, trying to get things that are safer ways of the GABA to get this back in balance, some for the acute first two, three, four, 5 days, and then especially for that first 2 to 6 months with things. We know that alcohol is involved in 80% of high school dropouts, 75% of teen suicides, 66% of teen pregnancies, and 50% of teen highway deaths. It also decreases your IQ, depending on when you started it, when they're looking at the Danish cohorts. You may hear people talk about naltrexone for alcohol, even though naltrexone is a cousin to Narcan and is the opioid receptor. It does also cover over the alcohol receptor center to kind of stop some of the cravings and make your brain think, oh, I'm okay. I don't need to have more alcohol to fill this. There is something called the Sinclair method that with the oral, we often try to time it just before people are going to have a drink to make it more effective. Because the naltrexone really peaks in a couple hours, has a strong effect for about 6 hours and goes down. So taking it in the morning, if you're going to drink after work, is really not going to probably be as effective. Vivitrol is also naltrexone. It goes up, it peaks about the third day, and then slowly comes down, roughly over a month, but some people come in earlier. And I always send people with an oral backup because there are times that there's a family reunion, a cookout, a wedding that they know that it's going to be high risk for going back and drinking. And if they can have the oral, they can try to punch it in the gut to not go backwards and hit that limit that puts them backwards very quickly. And in the middle, just before 2020, we now have had marijuana use surpassing alcohol. So I think a lot of people think, oh, opiates is substance use, but there's definitely more people that die from the alcohol effects. And now marijuana has taken over as the number one substance. Just a couple of things with medical marijuana that I think are sometimes misunderstood. Medical marijuana is just edibles or liquid. It's not plants, it's not smoked. There's never been a study that says, hey, let's take some plants and burn it and breathe it in, and it's going to be healthy for you. The oral is delayed by 30 to 60 minutes, and that's what's gotten a lot of, especially kids and teens, those teens in the 20s, guys especially, that just keep taking, and then all of a sudden it kicks in. And then now Canada has just reported they had a more than 25% increase in elderly that were using the edibles because of becoming intoxicated, off balance, and not realizing that it took a little bit longer before it took effect. There are no CBD receptors in the breathing center, so it's not going to stop you from breathing, but it can definitely affect your coordination. Because it's still a Schedule One, it's not covered by any medical insurance in Ohio, so it's only cash. When you get a medical marijuana card, it's only a recommendation. It's not a prescription. but it has to be from a certified physician, and then you take it to the dispensary. And like everything else in the brain and body, it was designed to be in balance, so that the CBD effects were trying to help negate the effects of the THC, which and when it's out of balance, that's when things can get out of control. And the percent of THC, because of the plants being re-engineered, is now 20 to 30 times higher than it was in the 60s. And when things are out of balance, it can and be used the wrong way, it can get you into trouble. They're also now finding more and more, and a lot, there's a lot of even marijuana researchers that are showing that there's sort of a sweet spot. And when you go beyond that, then you get much more side effects than help from that. And the usual US responses just keep getting more and more. But I think as it's becoming recreational now, or we're able to do studies, we'll be seeing more and more to be able to see where things are useful and where things are harmful with the THC CBD. And this just shows now in the general population is red, and with marijuana use in the green, all the different behavioral health components that are greatly increased when you had the THC component of the marijuana, or with marijuana, but the THC component, especially when it's out of balance. Denmark just published a study that they felt that 20 to 30% of schizophrenia was able to be preventable if they could stop the marijuana use before 16. And then long-term THC, we're still trying to find out more and more from it. We know that your IQ goes down. We're seeing much more cognitive impairment, and there seems to be much more ADHD, what people are using it during pregnancy. We're seeing a lot more with some cancers, even some different cancers. There's definitely a lot of heart issues that have been going on more and more. It affects how anesthesia is working on your body. And so there are several anesthesiologists that request that people refrain from marijuana for at least 7 to 10 days before they use it. And there's a study from OSU that's going on that just started to be able to try to see gene testing and see families and try to learn from the long-term effects of substances and also behavioral health. So we'll see what's coming. In the gas stations, you can get Delta 8. Right now, there's legislation to be able to try to ban this. Even though it says Delta 8, which is the THC 8, you can still have up to 1% of THC 9 in it. But they're finding that some of these that are supposed to be that way are actually even higher amounts. It has about 8 to 10% of the effect of THC 9, so, which is the very active component in marijuana. So if you're taking 8 to 10 times what you should be on the Delta 8, you could be having the same effects as the THC 9. So they're really trying to get this so it would need to be age restricted and even banned. So you may see more with that. We know that substance use increases suicide by 600%. Drug screens, we know that different substances will last certain lengths in your body. Cannabis, because it's fat soluble, once you've been using it for more than a week, will often stay for several weeks in your body before it's slowly put out. And it's the same thing with fentanyl, because it's also sticks into your fat. But we'll talk about, that's why I look at the levels of things, because there are two, when you're taking Suboxone or buprenorphine, there's buprenorphine and then the byproduct of it, which is norbuprenorphine. Both of these are active on the opiate receptor. The norbuprenorphine has about half the activity of buprenorphine. Buprenorphine, I think, if you remember with the dopamine, put it up to 400 versus heroin was in the 800-900 range. So it has, it's a partial agonist. It gives you just partially the dopamine surge that the other opiates do. Normally, these two get into a 1-to-2 ratio. And if we can get either 100 of the buprenorphine or 200 of the norbuprenorphine, it can usually stop cravings. But with fentanyl, we a lot of times we're trying to stop the pleasure that people get from fentanyl. So we try to shoot for at least 400 to 500. And if the levels are over 5,000, you have to be concerned. They took a piece of buprenorphine and dumped it into the urine because something was going on. But the other thing is is fentanyl and norfentanyl both pop the urine drug screens. Fentanyl is active, but norfentanyl is not. And norfentanyl is what the component that can last for weeks afterwards. So that's why when we're doing things, I try to get levels because there are times that people will still keep showing positive for fentanyl, but they really can be able to get Vivitrol or naltrexone, or they're not using more and more fentanyl. It's just that the norfentanyl needs to get out of their system. So, and in order to be successful, not only do we have to attack not getting the midbrain being yelled at to make more, we need to reprogram the frontal cortex or the inhibition center. And if that doesn't get reprogrammed to be able to find a trigger in which you're automatically reaching for something else, you finish work, you're going past the gas station, you're picking up a six pack, or if that doesn't get reprogrammed, it's not going to work. And I'm sure you've probably seen people come out of prison that have been in there 20 years. They come out, they go past an old dealer's house, they go past their favorite bar or whatever else, and boom, or they get yelled at by someone and they're going right back for the substance that was trying to bury the whatever it was that they were trying to bury. And then we also need to do things to build that dopamine back up, because it's if it's down at 10 or 20, you want to get it to build up. It'll slowly build up, but there are things that you can do to help build up dopamine a little bit faster. And there's never been anything that's been shown to be more rapid at helping your dopamine than finding your purpose and also serving others. Kind of biblical as to how that wisdom is, right? And there are a lot of people that have said that the opposite of addiction is connection. There were studies in the 50s that took rats and put them in these cages and left them all alone. And they would put them with water and with morphine. And what they were doing was seeing how much morphine it would take before they overdosed. Because when they were in this cage and that was all that they could live for, they would keep going for the morphine until they overdosed and died because they were trying to bury how bad life was. But they also found then this is certain amounts that we could make rats into addicts, but not kill them if we only give them this much morphine. And there was a scientist from Canada that said, well, what if we get people rats addicted to morphine, and then we build rat park and we could let them go in with other rats during the day. They get little whirly-girlies and all kind of good rat food. And then at nighttime, we put them back in that cage and we give them the same two choice of water or morphine and see what they do. And within a week, all the rats had stopped being addicts because they were getting their dopamine filled and they were getting all the right things to be able to enjoy life the way that rats' brains and rats' bodies were supposed to be. Oops. One of the things that we can see too with that, we know that obviously you saw COVID go crazy with people all of a sudden being alone. You can see one of the talks I do is at one of our schools, and I try to have it so it's near lunchtime because you can go in the cafeteria and you can ask some of the kids, who do you think is going to be in jail in 5 years? Who do you think is going to be in prison? Excuse me, who's going to be addicted to a substance in 5 years? And most of the time they can tell you, and most of the time those people are eating alone. And I know the school system that I'm with, they try to really key in on those kids so that they can have a better chance of long-term success. I think you've heard about Cheers and how a lot of people think, you know, why do people go to bars? One of the reasons is not just the beer. The Cheers theme song was making your way in the world today takes everything you've got, which is true. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Where everyone knows your name, where you're always glad you came, where you want to go, where people know that people are all the same. You want to go where everyone knows your name. And sometimes we need to maybe even have churches that are set up like bars at times. I don't know. So I'm going to add with a few little nothings. One thing is, I could go, I would be an emotional meltdown if I poured my heart out into every patient that I saw. And so I start the day by asking, who is it that I really need to put my attention to today? And it's usually very clear, that who it is that I need to really pour my heart, my emotions, my everything out to, so that I can do that, so that I don't wear myself down to nothing. Almost zero is the number of the people that can overcome addiction alone. We saw how Rat Park can affect things. A lot of people call me Joseph the Dreamer, because I wish that everyone that was coming out of the hospital that was in for a substance reason or for severe mental health or even a suicidal reason, or anyone that was coming out of our withdrawal unit, if they had someone that was alongside them, I know that it would increase the success that we have. And that's where peer support is important, but we just don't have anywhere near enough of what we should. And zero is the number of the treatment plans that work for everyone. I had showed you some of the different medicines at one place that were trying to hit different things if we see things out of balance. But there's not one single treatment that's going to be working for everyone. And a lot of things, just a medication by itself is not going to work if you're not dealing with the other things going on with the brain. And there are people that come to me, it's not working, but I'm going to find you the right person in the right place that's going to help, because the best treatment plan is the one that people will follow through on. Yeah. And zero is the number of the people that can recover when dead. And I think that's why a lot of us are doing what we're doing. So I had told them I would try to do 40 minutes. I'll take questions. I'm not sure what's in the chat. I'm going to stop sharing even.
Thank you so much for that great information. I was definitely drawn in and listening to everything you were saying and taking notes. But if anyone has any questions, John's also on from Relink, and we'd be happy to ask them to Dr. Baca.
Yeah, I know Vicki Van Dylen had her hand raised. Do you want to unmute yourself, Vicki, and ask a question or?
I'm thinking maybe because it's a webinar, maybe she can't. So she might
Oh,
just
if
type
you want to type it
it
in the chat or in the
in.
Q&A, Vicki, go right ahead. I had a couple quick questions, Dr. Baca, if you don't mind. So real quick, can naltrexone and Vivitrol be used in an emergency situation?
What do you mean by an emergency situation?
Like how Narcan is used?
Now the Vivitrol would not be reversing an opiate overdose because it takes 3 days to peak. The oral, you would need to be awake and able to swallow it because I don't think it has a lot of absorption under its tongue. And that's why we use the nasal or the IM route or IV to be able to reverse things. Boy, sometimes I hesitate to say some of the little tricks of things, but because buprenorphine sits stronger than any other opiate like fentanyl, there are people that have, when they didn't have Narcan available, but they had buprenorphine, they would be putting it under the tongue or crushing it and trying to put it up the nose of someone to be able to try to reverse things. And there have been reports that it reversed it because it sits stronger than the fentanyl does.
Okay. How about naltrexone for alcohol? Can that be used in an emergency or not?
I'm not sure what an emergency is, because again, it's the naltrexone is going to, the IM, the Vivitrol is going to take 3 days to peak. We usually wait a couple days or at least to see what their liver is doing, because if the liver is not working as well as it should, it needs the Vivitrol needs the liver to be able to process it the right way. And we can sometimes strain the liver by, if we're not checking things out and watching up on that.
I saw over in the chat we have awesome information, excellent presentation. Dr. Baca, are you accepting new patients?
I'm in the Mansfield area, and I am just with substance use. I'm kind of booked, but I also do work at the withdrawal unit at Catalyst in Mansfield with the rest of the team. And especially if people are needing into the withdrawal component and get those first few days under the physical part out, also part of that team that's there.
I had someone that said they wanted to say thank you. I've been a patient with you in the hospital for alcohol withdrawal and graduated from rehab a month ago, still sober, and appreciate the information and all you do for the community.
Awesome.
That was really nice. I really enjoyed your presentation. I think you did a great job relaying the importance of community and healing and treatment for mental illness. What was the name of the study you referenced?
The study. What
I'm
study?
on my thing.
Was it the study with the rats and being with other rats and offering them drugs or water? Is that the one?
That you can look, Dr. Alexander published several papers on that.
Dr. Alexander. Okay. I'll say thanks for the info. I work in the ED and I feel a lot more need to learn more on substance abuse.
And that's actually a hope, because I think a lot of people don't understand how hijacked people's brains are. And I think if you have a little better understanding, and also that this isn't just a let's get you through withdrawal and that's it, that is just the tip of the iceberg. We were just talking this afternoon. We tell people this is at least 2 years before opiate and alcohol is getting your brain back in balance, and 3 years for this stimulants. So this is not just a quick fix, which we really like a lot of times.
Hey, Dr. Baca, I know how fentanyl is being introduced into other pills and so forth. What about xylazine? Can you speak on that?
Xylazine is an animal tranquilizer, and then we've also now here recently had, I know Cleveland actually has seen something called metomidine, which is similar to us. Both of those are animal sedatives for when they're doing surgery, and they are not going to be reversed by Narcan because they're not an opiate. The newer one, the metamidine, is actually 100 times stronger even than the xylazine. And both of those take a little bit longer than fentanyl does to peak. So what we've seen when xylazine first came into our community, we had three people in 1 week that had overdosed. They got Narcan, started breathing a little bit, but then the xylazine kicked in, and they were too hypoxic by the time that someone called 911. And one of them was able to be an organ donor, but the other two were not. So that delayed is what's just adding to killing people, and it's part of that. Who knows what those three substances are? Fentanyl and meth seem to be mixed in with a lot of different things in our area. You just can't trust your drug dealers anymore. It's just
Yeah.
sad, but no, it's not sad, but it is sad.
Is there anything being created or been created to reverse xylazine or metabidine?
There is one that the anesthesiologist can use, a medication that's not available in most hospitals. So when they do come into the hospital, if that's where things are, some of them have needed to be on the respirator for hours to even longer with that, because it's not going to be reversed. And with both of those, because of the way they act, it can actually look like an opiate because the pupils become pinpoint. They're going to stop breathing. And the thing that you can give you a hint with that is it actually slows your heart rate down too. So it'll slow the heart rate versus that when it's the opiate that's doing it, you're still breathing, and often their heart rate is racing because they're not getting enough oxygen. But there's always going to be something else. I mean, always something's being created. That brain wanting to have new rewards and new things. That's why people mix in, add something else. Hey, this cocaine tastes even better than usual, and it's because it has fentanyl or it has xylazine or whatever else that it has mixed in with it.
Okay.
We had another question. Can you recommend some addiction trainings to learn from? And then there was a couple of questions after that.
I think it partly depends on your level for probably nurse for providers. The ASAM or American Society of Addiction Medicine has a lot of good library resources, some of which are paid for, some are free. And there's also something called Curbsiders that they has an addiction component that I have. That I also get end up learning a lot from. And if there are others, I'm always trying to learn different things. But I think those are probably two with depending on your level, you can be able to choose things that are in your interest and where your level is.
We have. Thank you, Dr. B. Learned a lot from you today. You're always so informative. Are there any natural herbs or vitamins that may help balance the brain?
A lot of that depends. There are a lot of different things that can help different ways. We know that alcohol lets your doesn't let your liver process things the right way, especially for your bone marrow. So often because of that, you need to have extra thiamine, folic acid, B12 as part of things. There is a supplement called N-acetylcysteine that has getting a lot of research, seems to be beneficial, especially for a lot of the stimulants for THC, for meth, for cocaine. For a lot of people, it can help the picking component from meth. We know too, if your salts are out of balance, if you're low sodium, low potassium, low magnesium, it's much harder for your muscles to be able to recuperate the right way. I know other things have been touted, vitamin C and some others, but I haven't seen any consistent. But I think part of it would be what substance you were doing. Especially meth and cocaine, a lot of time in alcohol, your nutrition is absolutely horrendous. You're getting just your calories from bad carbohydrates. And so your protein is way off, and you're going to need a lot more nutrition than others' substances.
I had a client on Sublocade report that if they massage their injection site in a hot shower, it released more medication and were able to get high. Is that possible?
Sublocade was designed to be as a ball and slowly come apart. When people have rubbed it, it's going to be the absorption is going to be different. And yeah, that can be a potential, not side effect, but an infection, potential thing that people have found. The same way that Suboxone, the reason it has the naloxone in it, it's not that you get sick from it or get reversed from it. It's because if you crush it up and snort it or melt it down and do it IV, you'll get the buprenorphine and then you'll get 2 milligrams of Narcan and get that reversed and get sick with that. So people will find all kinds of creative ways. I didn't put some here, but to be able to even abuse other medications, if you, especially snorting or doing things can still get people to get a high with it. The same way that you can get a high with buprenorphine if you get it where you get a sudden surge of it.
We did have someone else ask about accepting new patients. I know you said that your plate is pretty full right now, but do you have other doctors that you recommend or people who might be accepting new patients right now?
I think see where you are and I'm not sure what's on Relink as far as providers, but if in your community to see others that and talk to them. And I'm not going to be the one for everyone. That's the thing too, because that's why there's good that there's other people around for different things.
I think that is all of our questions today. I
Okay.
really appreciate your time. I know you volunteered your time today to come on and share with us, and we really appreciate that. We're thankful for it, and we hope that people learn lots of good information. We had a lot of great comments I didn't even read, so thank you so much.
Well, that's good. I thank you for this chance. I thank you for what you're doing too. And we're in this together, and hopefully, this is going to be able to be used for people to help take better care of their patients too.
Appreciate it.
Thank
Have
you
a
so
good
much,
day,
Dr.
everyone.
Baca.
All right. Everyone, have a good afternoon.
You as well.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye.